Hello student, welcome to my YouTube channel. In this video, I am going to discuss about Lorentz force and cyclotron. Okay, so before starting this topic, I just want to make you clear motion of charge particle in uniform electric field and magnetic field so that you can understand the topic easily. Okay, so let's start with you motion of a charged particle in uniform electric field. Clear? Just see in figure. Consider a charged particle of charge plus Q and mass m is moving along OX with velocity v. In the absence of electric field, this charged particle meets the screen at point C. Clear? So let the charged particle be subjected to a uniform electric field as shown in figure. Charged particle subjected uniform electric field E acting along OY. Clear? So due to this electric field, this charged particle experiences a force which is given by F equal to QE. This force is acting along OY direction. Now, acceleration of the charged particle is given by A equal to QE upon M. Clear? This acceleration being perpendicular to the motion of charged particle, it will not change the speed of charged particle along OX. Clear? So, if X is the distance, just see in figure, this X is distance. This is distance. Clear? X is length of the region of electric field, then time taken by the charged particle is given by T equal to X upon M. I hope this is clear to you. The horizontal. If Y is the transverse that deflection during time T. Clear? If Y is the displacement, see in figure. This is Y is displacement. This is displacement here. Y is displacement of the charged particle along Y direction in the electric field during this time T. So then using relation S equal to UT plus half AT square. S equal to UT plus half a t square. It is UT plus half a t square. We know U equal to 0. Okay. Now A equal to QE upon M and T equal to X upon V. So it is given by Y equal to half a t square equal to 1 by 2 QE upon M into X upon V whole square. So from this equation on solving, we will get Y equal to QE upon 2M V square into X. So it is Y equal to KX square, where QE upon 2M V square is constant K. Clear? So we can write this equation Y equal to KX square. This is the equation of parabola. So hence, inside electric field, the charged particle moves on a parabolic path. Clear? And on leaving the field, it moves along a straight line, AB, as shown in this figure. AB is a straight line. Okay? Straight path AB. Tangent to the curved path as shown in figure. Clear? When charged particle moves in electric field, it moves in parabolic path. I hope this is clear to you. As in first slide, T is given by T equal to X upon M. This is not X upon M, this is T equal to X upon V. We can write T equal to here, equation 2, T equal to X upon V. I hope this is clear to you. Clear? When charged particle moves in an electric
fill its covered parabolic path. Okay. So now if the charged particle remain in field for time t, that is x upon v, during this time the velocity of charged particle increases in the vertical direction while its horizontal velocity remains same. Okay, so therefore as the charged particle leave the electric field, its vertical velocity v1 is given by, from first equation of motion, v1 equal to v0 plus at. Here v0 equal to 0. Plus A equal to QE upon M and T equal to X upon V. So from this equation, we will get V1 equal to QE upon M into X upon V. Clear? So if theta is the theta is deflection with X axis at with the charged particle emerges from the electric field. So tan theta is given by V1 upon V. So now put the value of V1 and V in this equation. Clear? So the energy of the charged particle is increased by the amount of half m V1 square. As it passes through the electric field and energy due to the horizontal velocity. Remain? Clear? So this was something about when the charged particles move in electric field, it's covered parabolic path. Here, if the charged particle is moving opposite to the direction of field, it experiences a force minus QE, hence it is retarded. And if charged particle having charge Q is at rest or moving in the direction of field, it experiences a force QE in the direction of electric field. Hence the particle accelerates in the direction of E. And if charged particle move perpendicular to the electric field, it describes a parabolic path in electric field. So it was something about when charged particle in uniform electric field. Now come to next point. Motion of a charged particle in uniform magnetic field. For this, consider a charged particle of mass m and charge q, which is moving with velocity v. It entering a uniform magnetic field B, so in as shown in figure, charged particle entering in this field with velocity v. Okay, at O from here. This is v velocity. This velocity has component v cos theta and v sine theta. Clear? So V cos theta acts in the direction of magnetic field while V sin theta acts perpendicular to the direction of field. Clear? So charged particle moving the magnetic field, the velocity component circular perpendicular to the magnetic field creates circular motion. Whereas the component of the velocity parallel to the field moves the horizontal distance between two consecutive circuits. The resulting motion is helical motion. Clear? So motion of a charged particle along magnetic field. When charged particle moves along magnetic field. Clear? There are two possibilities. It encloses angle of 0 degree or 180 degree. In either case, sine of the angle is 0. So magnetic field is 0 and the motion of particle remains unaffected. Clear? Now motion of the charged particle perpendicular to the field. So in this case, charged particle experience a maximum force, which is given by F equal to QBV sine theta is 90 degree. So we can write F equal to QVB. So if the span of magnetic field is sufficient around the charged particle, then it will describe a circular path. As magnetic field is always perpendicular to the motion. Clear? So this magnetic field provides the centripetal force required for the circular motion. Here we consider some intrinsic intrinsic cases as shown in the figure. For all cases, we assume that motion of charged particle is in plane of the drawing and the magnetic field is perpendicular into the plane of the drawing. Clear? So magnetic field is shown by the distribution indicating that it is an uniform magnetic field. Clear? So from in this figure, motion of charged particle and magnetic field. From in first figure, we see that there is a sufficient span of magnetic field around the charged particle. In first figure, charged particle is able to describe circular paths. Charged particle is able to describe circular path. In second case, the charged particle enters the region of magnetic field and never completes the circular trajectory. Similarly, in third case, we see that particles also does not complete the circular path as it comes out of the region of magnetic field even before completing half circle. Clear? So now we consider first case in which charged particle is able to complete circular path. Let the mass of the particle is m, then magnetic force is equal to centripetal force, which is given by mv square upon r equal to qvb. So we can write this equation mv upon r equal to qb, where r is the radius. Clear? So the radius of the circular path is r, which is given by from above equation r equal to mv upon qb. Clear? So if the charged particle move in a magnetic field, it has two components. Component v sine theta and component v cos theta. Component of velocity v sine theta acts perpendicular to the direction of magnetic field, and component v cos theta acts in the direction of magnetic field. Clear? So component v sine theta, the force acting on the charged particle due to magnetic field is given by qvb sine theta, which is qvb. Here theta is 90 degree. We know sine 90 is 1. So direction of this force is perpendicular to the plane containing b and v. Is directed at right hand rule. As this force is to remain always perpendicular to v2. It does not perform any work. Hence, it cannot change the magnitude of velocity. It changes only direction of the particle. So due to it, the charged particle made to move in a circular path due to this velocity. Clear? Now for component v cos theta, there will be no force on a charged particle in magnetic field. Clear? So because angle between v and b is zero, the charged particles covers a linear distance due to this component. Clear? So therefore, under the combined effect of these two velocities, the charged particle in magnetic field will cover linear path as well as circular path. So we can say that charged particle in magnetic field covers helical path, whose axis is parallel to the direction of magnetic field. Clear? So this is the motion of a charged particle in magnetic field. This is this figure, motion of charged particle in magnetic field. This is helical path. I hope this is clear to you. From this figure, radius r is radius of curvature, f is force, v is velocity, force directed towards helical axis, which is parallel to b. Clear? Now the linear distance covered by charged particle in the magnetic field in time equal to one revolution of its circular path, which is called pitch of helix, which is given by d equal to v1 into t. So we can write V1 is V cos theta and T is 2 pi m upon V, 2 pi m upon BQ. Right? So if charged particle having charge Q is at rest in magnetic field, it experiences no force. Since V is zero, so F is zero. If charged particle moving parallel to direction of magnetic field, it also does not experience any force because angle between V and B is zero. And if charged particle is moving perpendicular to direction of field, it experiences maximum force. Clear? So it was something about charged particle move in electric magnetic field. When charged particle move in electric field, it experience a force. It moves in a parabolic path. And if charged particle moves in magnetic field, it covered helical path. Clear? So now come to magnetic force. What is magnetic force? So consider a positive charge as shown in figure. Charge Q is moving in uniform magnetic field B. This is a uniform magnetic field B with velocity V. This velocity is making angle theta with uniform magnetic field B, right? Due to interaction between magnetic field produced due to moving charge and magnetic field applied, the charge Q then experience a force which is given by the following factor. Magnitude of this force is directly proportional to Q, which is Q. Magnitude of force is directly proportional to component of velocity acting perpendicular to the direction of magnetic field. Magnetic field V sine theta. V sine theta is perpendicular component of this velocity V. Magnitude of this force is directly proportional to magnetic field B. So on combining these quantities, these equations, we will get F equal to Q V B sine theta. Clear? Now F equal to K into Q VB sine theta, where K is constant of proportionality, its value is found to be 1. So we can write force experienced by a particle in magnetic field is given by F equal to Q VB sine theta. Clear? Since F is a vector quantity, so vector form of this force is given by F equal to Q V vector cross B vector. Clear? So the current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field experiences a force, which means that moving charge in a magnetic field experiences a force, which is given by F equal to QVB. F equal to VB. Or we can write F equal to QVB sine theta, where theta is angle between V vector and B vector. Clear? Now let's talk about special cases. First case is if the charged particle is rest, that means V is zero. If V is zero, from force QVB sine theta, force is zero. So a stationary charge in magnetic field does not experience any force, right? If theta is zero or 180 degree, that is if the charged particles move parallel to or anti-parallel to the direction of magnetic field, force is also zero. Since sine zero or sine 180 degree is also zero. Clear? Now if theta is 90 degree, that means if the charged particle move perpendicular to the magnetic field, then force is maximum. Since sine 90 is 1, so force is given by F equal to QVB. I hope this is clear to you. Now what is Fleming's left hand rule? Direction of this force determined by Fleming's left hand rule.
phlegmic left hand root is if the central finger, as shown in figure, central finger, forefinger and thumb of left hand are straight mutually perpendicular to each other as shown in figure. The central finger points the current. This is the central finger which points the current. Forefinger points the magnetic field. Clear? And the thumb points the direction of this force on the current carrying conductor. Clear? So what is Fleming's left hand rule? If we stress the first finger, central finger and thumb of left hand mutually perpendicular to each other, such that first finger points the direction of magnetic field, central points the direction of electric current, and the thumb represents the direction of force experienced by a charged particle. Clear? Now, force on a moving charge in uniform electric and magnetic field. Force on a charged particle in uniform electric and magnetic field, or we can say Lorentz force. The force experienced by a charged particle in a space where both electric and magnetic fields exist, called Lorentz force. So we know that force on a charged particle due to electric field is given by F equal to QE, FE equal to QE. Clear? Force due to magnetic field is given by F equal to FM equal to QV cross B. Right? FE equal to QE. We can write force due to electric field is F equal to QE, where E is electric field. Force due to magnetic field is given by FM equal to QV cross B. Clear? The direction of this force is direction of V cross B, that is perpendicular to the plane containing V and B, and is directed as given by left hand screw rule. Sorry, right hand screw rule. So due to both electric and magnetic field, total force experienced by charged particle is given by F equal to FE plus FM. So we can write QE plus QV cross B, right? So this is Lorentz force. Okay, now let's talk about some special case when V, velocity, electric field and magnetic field, all three are collinear. V, B and E all are collinear. So in this situation, the charged particle moving parallel or anti-parallel to the field, the magnetic force on the charged particle zero. Due to this force, theta is zero. Due to this condition, theta is zero. So magnetic force is zero. Clear? So it will experience only electric field, electric force. So due to this electric force, the acceleration is given by A equal to QE upon M. Clear? So this acceleration is along the direction of electric field. As a result of which, there will be no change in speed of charged particle along the direction of this field. In this situation, there will be no change in the direction of motion of the charged particle, but speed, velocity, momentum, and kinetic energy all will change. Clear? And if V, E, and B, velocity, electric field, and magnetic field are mutually perpendicular to each other, then in this situation, electric field and magnetic field are such that net force is zero. So we can write FE equal to FM. Clear? Then acceleration in the particle is zero. It means particle will pass through the fields without any change in its velocity. Clear? So we can write QE equal to QVB. From this equation, we can write V equal to V equal to E upon B. This concept has been used to velocity selector to get the charge beam having a definite velocity. Clear? So now come to the topic cyclotron. What is cyclotron? So cyclotron is the type of particle accelerator invented by Ernst O. Lorentz in 1934, in which charged particle accelerate outward from the center along a spiral path. The particle are held to a spiral trajectory by a static magnetic field and accelerated by a rapidly varying electric field. Clear? What is cyclotron? Cyclotron is a device which is used to accelerate a charged particle like proton, neutron, etc. can be accelerated. It is invented by Ernst Lorentz in 1934. Clear? Now, what is the principle of cyclotron? So, cyclotron, it is used to accelerate particles to high energy. An electric field can accelerate a charged particle and perpendicular magnetic field gives the ion circular path. Clear? So, principle of this cyclotron is, it is based on the fact that a positively charged particle can be accelerated due to a sufficiently high energy with the help of smaller values of oscillating electric field by making it to cross the same electric field time and again with the use of strong magnetic field. Clear? Now talk about construction. So cyclotron consists of two D-shaped hollow evacuated metal chamber D1 and D2. Clear? D1 and D2 are called D's. These D's are placed horizontally with their diameter as shown in figure. In this figure, these are two D's. This is D1 and this is D2. Clear? These D's are placed horizontally with their diameter as is, parallel and slightly separated from each other. Clear? As shown in figure. These D's are connected to high frequency oscillator. Okay? Which can produce a potential difference of the order of 10 raised to power 4 volt at frequency 10 raised to power 7 hertz. These two D's are enclosed in a evacuated steel box and are well insulated from it. The box is placed in a strong magnetic field produced by two poles. This is North Pole, this is South Pole. Clear? Two pole pieces of strong electromagnet. Magnetic field is perpendicular to the plane of D's. Clear? So this is the construction of cyclotron. It consists of a two semicircular D1 and D2 encloses a chamber. This chamber is placed between two magnets as shown in figure. Clear? Now an AC voltage is applied between these D1 and D2 and ion capped in vacuum chamber. Right? Now, at a certain instant, let D1 be at positive potential, positive, and D2 is at negative, right? So ion will be accelerated towards D1 and describe a semicircular path. When the particle reaches the gap, D2 become negative and D1 become positive. So ion is accelerated towards D2 and undergoes a circular path with larger radius. This process repeats again and again. Thus, the ion comes near the edge of the D with high kinetic energy. This ion can be directed towards the target by a deflecting plate. Right? So now let's come to theory. Charged particle, positive ion to be accelerated
here, just see in this figure, this is a diagram. In this charged particle is placed here. Clear? Positive ion to be accelerated is produced at P. Suppose this is P point at this point. Suppose at any instant, we can say this is D1, this is D2. D1 is at negative potential and D2 is at positive potential at any instant. Therefore, the ion will be accelerate towards D1. Clear? D1 is negative or D2 is at positive. So, ion will towards D1. On reaching inside D1, the ion will be in a field free space. So, it moves in a constant speed in D1, say V. But due to perpendicular magnetic field, the ion will describe a circular path. This is clear. Now, due to the circular path, which is given by BQB equal to MV squared upon R. Clear? Here, positive ion P to be accelerated space between the two Ds. At any time, D1 is at negative potential and D2 is at positive potential. Then the ion gets accelerated towards D1. But since it is perpendicular to B, it describes a circular path of the radius R. Clear? And Lorentz force provides the centripetal force. So, which is given by BQV equal to MV square upon R. So we can write R equal to MV upon Q, MV upon QV. Clear? Now, time taken to describe the semicircle is given by T equal to pi R upon V. P equal to pi R upon V. So we can write pi M upon BQ. Or we can write pi upon B into Q upon M equal to constant. So this time is independent of both the speed of ion and radius of the circular path. Clear? So in case the time during which the positive ion describes a semicircular path is equal to time during which half cycle of electric oscillator is completed, then as the ion arrives in the gap between these two Ds, the polarity of the two Ds is reversed. That is, in this time, D1 become positive and D2 become negative. Clear? So in this time is equal to time during which D1 and D2 change their polarity. The ion get accelerated. Clear? Ion gets accelerated. When it arrives in between the gap, the electric field accelerates the ion further. Once ion is inside the D2, it now describes a greater semicircle due to the magnetic field, right? This process repeats and ion goes on describing a circular path of greater radius, finally acquires a high energy and ion further removed from the window W. The maximum energy acquired by the ion source is given by MV square upon R not equal to BQV. Clear? So we can write V naught is velocity, which is equal to BQ R naught upon M, right? BQ R naught upon M. So maximum kinetic energy is given by half M V naught square equal to half M, and write the value of BQ R naught square upon R naught upon M whole square. So kinetic energy is given by V square Q square R naught square upon 2M. Clear? So the frequency of cyclotron is given by B equal to qb upon 2 pi m. I hope this is clear to you. Clear when d1 is at positive and d2 is at negative, the ion move towards d2, and when it come in up in d2, it's moves with a circular path. Clear? And with greater speed, which remains constant in d2, then the ion will describe a semicircular path of greater radius due to a perpendicular magnetic field, and again it will arrive in a gap between these two d's. Right? Exactly at this instant, the polarity of two d's is reversed, and in that case d1 is at negative and d2 is at positive, and ion will go towards d1 and it moves with greater radius in d1, covers a semicircular path, and it comes into the gap between 2D and will go on describe circular path of greater and greater radius, and finally it acquires a sufficiently high energy. The accelerated ion can be removed out of the D's from window by applying the electric field across the deflecting plate E and F. Clear? So maximum kinetic energy is given by B square Q square naught square upon 2m. Now cyclotron frequency, if T is time period, is given by T equal to 2 into T. So which is given by T equal to pi m upon BQ. And cyclotron frequency is 1 upon T, so QB upon 2 pi m. Clear? It is also known as magnetic resonance frequency. Clear? Now, the cyclotron angular frequency, is given by omega equal to 2 pi m, 2 pi v, 2 pi nu. Here, nu is the frequency. So, it is given by B Q upon m. This is angular frequency of cyclotron. So, are you getting my point? Now, what is the limitation of cyclotron? This was something about introduction of cyclotron, principle of cyclotron, construction of cyclotron, and working and theory of cyclotron. Now, what about limitation of cyclotron? So, limitation of cyclotron is, first is, cyclotron cannot accelerate uncharged particles like neutron. Clear? Now, cyclotron cannot accelerate electron because it's a small mass. Okay. Cyclotron is suitable only for accelerating heavy particle like proton, neutron, alpha particle. Electron cannot be accelerated by the cyclotron because mass of electron is small. And a small increase in energy of the electron make the electron move with a very high speed. As a result of it, the electron go quickly out of the step with oscillating electric field. Clear? Now third is, it cannot accelerate positively charged particle with large mass due to relativistic effect. When positive ion is accelerated by the cyclotron, it moves with greater and greater speed. As a result, the speed of ion becomes comparable with to the speed of light. The mass of ion increase according to relation. We know that relation m equal to m naught upon under root 1 minus v square over c square, where m naught is the rest mass of ion, m is the mass of ion while moving with velocity v, and c is velocity of light. So now the time taken by the ion to describe semi-circular path is given by t equal to pi m upon vq, bq. So we can write p upon pi upon bq multiply m upon under root 1 minus v square over c square, right? So it shows that if v increases, t increases. It means positive ion will take longer time to describe semicircular path than the time of half cycle of oscillating electric field, right? So as a result of it, the ion will not arrive in the gap between the two D's exactly at the instant. The polarity of the two D's is reversed. and it will not be accelerated further. So therefore, the ion cannot move with a velocity beyond a certain limit in a cyclotron. Clear? Only when the speed of the circulating is less than c, the speed of light, we find the frequency of revolutions to be independent of its speed. Clear? At high speed, mass of the ion will increase and this changes the time period of ion revolutions. This results in the ion lagging behind the electric field and it eventually loses by collisions against the walls of the disk. Clear? As I told you, the cyclotron is suitable for accelerating heavy charged particle. It's not suited for very high kinetic energy. So I hope this is clear to you. Now, uses of cyclotron. So cyclotron is used, the high energy particle produced in a cyclotron are used to bombard nuclei and study the resulting nuclear reaction and hence investigate nuclear structures. The high energy particles are used to produce other high energy particles such as neutrons by collision. These fast neutrons are used in atomic reactors. And it is also used to impart ions into solid and modify their properties or even synthesis new material. Clear? So this was something about cyclotron and Lorentz force. Clear? So I hope you got my point. What is cyclotron and what is the principle of cyclotron? What is the construction and how it works? Clear? And what are the limitations of cyclotrons and where we use the cyclotron? So let's come to some problem that you have to solve. The first problem is given. In a chamber, a uniform magnetic field of 6.5 G. Clear? So 1G equal to 10 raised to power minus 4 Tesla is maintained. An electron is shot into the field with speed 4.8 into 10 raised to power 6 meter per second, normal to this field. So explain why the path of the electron is circle. Clear? And determine the radius of the circular orbit. Clear? So you can solve this problem applying Lorentz magnetic force, which acts as a centripetal force and makes the electron move in a circular path. So which is given by mv square. We can write mv square upon r equal to qvb sine 90 is 1. So find the value of r. R equal to mv upon e qb. Right? And frequency of revolution is given by nu equal to eb upon 2 pi m that we have studied in cyclotron. Clear? So you can solve this numerical applying these two formula. Now next problem is given by an electron travels in a circular path of radius 20 centimeter in a magnetic field of 2 into 10 to the power minus 3 Tesla. Find speed and the potential difference through which the electron should be accelerated to acquire this speed. Clear? Mass and charge of electron is given. Right? So how will you solve this question? Here you are given radius, magnetic field, charge on electron and mass on electrons. You have to find potential difference and speed. So for speed, you apply formula V equal to E. You apply formula V equal to, we know that Q, B, R upon M, right? And for potential difference, let V be the potential difference through which the electron is accelerated. So kinetic energy is given by half mv square equal to q into v, where v is potential. So from this equation, find the value of potential. So v equal to given by m v square upon 2q. Put the values of in these equations and find the answer. Right? Now next question. Next question is, an alpha particle has mass 6.4 10 to the power say, minus 27 kilogram and charge 3.2 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb moves through a magnetic field of 0.25 tesla and describes circular path of radius 40 centimeter. Find the velocity of particles and frequency of wave. So you can find the velocity and frequency by using formula that you have studied in cyclotron, right? Now last question is, proton and alpha particle, their masses is given the in ratio 1:4 and charge in the ratio of 1:2. Move perpendicular to magnetic field. Find the ratio and radius of the circular path described by them when both they have